Ambassador of Colombia, Mauricio Rodriguez, Ambassador of Mexico to the United Kingdom, Eduardo Medina Mora, Virginia Comoli, researcher of the IISS, and members of the British government, members of the diplomatic corps accredited to the United Kingdom, colleagues and friends. I would like to start by thanking Ambassador Mauricio Rodriguez and Juan Manuel Uribe for their hospitality and for organizing this book presentation. Both for Alejandro and for me, but especially for Universidad de los Andes, it is a great opportunity to be able to share with you tonight the contents of the book and the main messages that come out of it, and to tell you about the research agenda that we've been developing at Universidad de los Andes on drugs and security. I would also like to thank Ambassador Eduardo Medina Mora and Virginia Comoli for accepting the invitation to discuss our book tonight and to share their views on drug policy and security in Latin America. Also, I would like to thank the Global Drug Policy Program and the Latin America Program of the Open Society for their support and funding for the different initiatives that we've been developing at the Universidad de los Andes. Their support has been crucial for us to be able to push forward this research agenda and to consolidate Universidad de los Andes as a pivotal institution in Latin America on these issues. About 3 years ago, when the president of Universidad de los Andes at the time, Dr. Carlos Angulo, entrusted Alejandro and me with the task of compiling a book on drug policy in Colombia. From the beginning, Dr. Angulo gave us constant support and guided us towards the goal that he himself had intended, to produce an academic publication from Universidad de los Andes with the purpose of contributing to an objective, constructive, and informed debate on drug policy in Colombia. Some of us who have been working on the subject for some years, and others, like Professor Álvaro Camacho, who has spent many years studying drug trafficking and its social, economic, and political consequences, set out to the task of finding researchers at Universidad de los Andes who were, from diverse areas of knowledge, interested in studying the many dimensions, consequences, side effects, effectiveness, and costs of drug policies in Colombia. It was after nearly two years of work that we published, in April of last year, the book Anti-Drug Policies in Colombia, Successes, Failures, and Lost Opportunities. The book deals with various issues such as international relations and drug policy, the effects and costs of Plan Colombia, money laundering, drug consumption and policies to prevent it, and the multiple connections between drug trafficking, violence, and organized crime. 3 years ago, when the university decided to dive into this research agenda, I think that not even the most radical advocates for a change in drug policy felt that the debate on the current international drug stance was going to evolve as quickly as it has in recent months. In an important way, the debate began to intensify 3 years ago, when we were starting to work on the book at Universidad de los Andes with the publication of the report of the Latin American Commission on Drugs and on Democracy, headed by former presidents Cardoso, Gaviria, and Zedillo. Then, about 1 year ago, other world-class personalities like Kofi Annan, Paul Schultz, and Richard Branson, among others, joined the three former Latin American presidents and published the report of the World Commission on Drugs. It was a few months later that Colombian president, in a courageous attitude, encouraged the international community, other presidents in Latin America, and especially the US government, to engage in a frank discussion based on the available empirical and academic evidence about the effectiveness and costs of the current drug regime. President Santos was followed by Central American presidents like Otto Pérez Molina, who introduced the issue of drug legalization, to which I will refer later. The book that we are presenting today compiles the research of a diverse group of professors and researchers at Universidad de los Andes. Diverse in the broadest sense, methodologically, conceptually, and even ideologically. However, there is a clear theme, a constant in all chapters. The respect for facts, the propensity to analyze data and judge policies, not by their intentions or by their attachment to a particular doctrine, but by its results and effects on the economic, social, and institutional domains. The book is divided in five sections. The first one, the dimensions of the drugs problem in Colombia, production, trafficking, and consumption, consists of two chapters. The first one describes the production and trafficking of cocaine in Colombia, quantifies the value added generated by this business, and discusses the macroeconomic importance of cocaine production and trafficking in the Colombian economy. Chapter 2 examines the evolution of drug use in Colombia during the last 15 years, characterizes the consumption of illicit drugs, and analyzes in a preliminary way the effects on domestic consumption of the mid-90s Constitutional Court ruling that ordered to decriminalize the so-called personal dose. The second part of the book, Policies for the Reduction of Supply and Demand, studies anti-drug policies in Colombia. Three policies are comprehensively analyzed in these chapters: the recent policy of control over cocaine production and trafficking under Plan Colombia, alternative development policies, and those efforts aimed at reducing the consumption of illegal drugs with treatment and prevention policies. Chapter 3 discusses the effectiveness, cost, and efficiency of anti-drug policies implemented under Plan Colombia. Chapter 4 studies the alternative development programs and particularly the most recent efforts aimed at controlling illicit crops by promoting legitimate agricultural activities among coca growers. Chapter 5 describes the programs, scarce and disjoint in general, of demand reduction and treatment of drug consumers in Colombia. The third part of the book deals with the issue of international relations and anti-drug policies in Colombia, and explores the interplay between drug trafficking problems in Colombia and international relations. This part of the book contains three chapters. Together, these chapters show that the efforts of several Colombian governments for narcotizing the foreign policy agenda, with the overriding objective of obtaining help and funding for the war on drugs, have led to wrong decisions, to disagreement with countries that have a different approach to the drugs problem, and to the neglect of important issues in the country's foreign policy agenda. Chapter 6 shows, for example, that in order to counter the lack of interest in the issue of drugs of some multilateral organizations, Colombian governments have followed the deliberate strategy, rhetoric we might say, of highlighting the links between drug production and trafficking with other issues that do have priority for these organizations, such as terrorism, the environment, and human rights concerns. Chapter 7 describes the recent disagreements between the European Union and Colombia regarding drug policy. While Colombia has historically insisted on a more repressive approach, the European Union has tended to emphasize a more balanced approach, based, for example, in policies of harm reduction to confront the consumption of illegal drugs. Chapter 8 shows how the securitization of drug policies have prevented a broader and constructive debate in the relationship between Colombia and the US. The chapter points out, among many other things, that Colombia should take advantage of the current situation in the United States in order to promote an open debate on the prohibitionist stance and an objective assessment of the costs and benefits of Plan Colombia. The fourth part of the book addresses the legal and institutional aspects of the war on drugs in Colombia. Chapter 9, for instance, presents a detailed study of a constitutional court ruling that ordered the decriminalization and possession of small doses of narcotics. Based on a description of the daily application of this ruling in the streets of Bogota, the chapter shows the divergence between what the ruling states and its practical implementation in the streets, especially in cases that involve deprived persons and low-income young men, who are a priori perceived by the national police as potential generators of violence and social problems. Chapter 10 describes the various legal responses of the state of Colombia to confront drug trafficking and related crimes. The chapter shows that the definition of new criminal offenses and the establishment of harsher penalties have not led, in general, to a significant reduction in narcotic-related crimes. Finally, Chapter 11 addresses the issue of money laundering. The chapter makes an enormous effort to quantify money laundering in Colombia and to identify the channels through which the revenues from drug trafficking activities enter the Colombian economy. The last part of the book, entitled Legal and Institutional Aspects of the War on Drugs, contains four chapters. Chapter 12 shows, in its initial part, how drug trafficking penetrated the political, economic, and social spheres of Colombia, thereby altering the country's course of history. The second part of this chapter discusses a more recent problem, the combination of drug trafficking, paramilitaries, and politics, which gave rise to the recent scandal known as Parapolitica. Chapter 13 examines the effects of drug trafficking on the opinions and political behaviors of Colombians. It shows how people living in areas with illicit crops are less likely to participate in political processes and rely less on the institutions of the state. Ariel's spraying campaigns, for instance, lead to a significant decline of trust in institutions such as the National Police. Chapter 14 examines the relationship between drug trafficking and organized crime. The chapter shows in particular that criminal shows initially produced by the emergence of drug trafficking activities were reproduced endogenously given the diminished ability of police and judicial institutions to react in a timely manner. Finally, the last chapter of the book reviews the links of violent organizations with drug trafficking business in Colombia during the last 3 decades. The chapter presents 2 case studies in order to explore the role of violent organizations in the production and trafficking of cocaine in Colombia during the last few years. There are many policy recommendations that I derive from the analysis of each chapter of the book. However, the book as a whole and the analysis that we've been doing at Universidad de Los Andes lead us to a few general points and recommendations that I would like to highlight today. First, in our view, the Colombian government should not feel like one more guest to this debate. Rather, it should, together with the government of Mexico, feel as the hosts of this debate. If these two governments do not lead the debate, at least at the regional level, it is difficult to think that someone else will. Several people have pointed out repeatedly that countries such as Colombia and Mexico have the moral authority and experience and knowledge to propose and lead this debate, which should begin at the regional level and then be scaled up to international institutions such as the UN. Only by taking the control of the debate, it is possible to ensure that this critical discussion takes place in the domains of evidence-based analysis and not on predetermined ideological positions. At the end of the day, we all want a world without problematic drug consumption, without major drug cartels, without violence associated with illegal drug markets. However, drug policy, like any other policy, must be judged by its results and not by its intentions. We need pragmatism and a careful analysis of the cost and benefits of different alternatives. This should be the guiding points to the debate in the near future. The current debate on drug policy should not be based on simplistic solutions derived from preconceived ideological positions, but on analysis and research that takes into account the available evidence about what works, what doesn't, and at what cost in terms of drug policy. For example, the idea of legalization is so simplistic and so radical as the position advocating for total prohibition. As we mentioned in the introduction of the book, policies based on evidence are not only more effective in general, they also encourage a more open debate on the best way of confronting a complex and to a certain extent unsolvable problem that will probably remain with us forever. The drugs problem in Colombia is impossible to separate from the security problems and the violence that has plagued the country in recent decades. The advent of drug trafficking, as Alejandro was explaining, in Colombia during the 70s, prompted an unprecedented increase in the homicide rate, which went from a level below 30 homicides per 100,000 inhabitants to a level above 70 in the 90s. Other kinds of crime, including extortion, kidnappings, and armed trafficking, also flourished as a result of the consolidation of organized crime linked to drug trafficking and the consequent weakening of the judicial system. Some preliminary research that we've been doing at Los Andes indicates that if the size of illegal drug markets had not grown to the extent it did, about 120% between 1994 and 2008, the homicide rate in Colombia would be about 36% lower. That is, it would be 23 homicides per 100,000 inhabitants instead of 37. 23 is basically the homicide rate of the average Latin American country. So Colombia would be an average Latin American country if drug production and trafficking hadn't increased to the extent it did. The displacement rate would be 60% lower, and the number of attacks by illegal armed groups would be 43% lower. In short, the advent of drug trafficking in Colombia produced an unprecedented increase in violent crime, first in some states, and later throughout the country. As long as the global drug regime maintains a strict prohibitionist stance, Colombia and other countries in the region will have to militarily confront the illegal armed groups and the organized criminal organizations linked to drug trafficking. In the end, it is out of the drug trafficking business that they obtain most of their resources. Colombia has made great advances in this area, especially since 2007-2008, when policymakers at the Ministry of Defense revalued some strategies and decreased the strong emphasis in aerial spraying campaigns of coca crops and moved on to attacking other steps in the chain that produce the highest value added. the detection and destruction of laboratories for processing cocaine, the interdiction of large shipments of cocaine, and the blocking of drug trafficking routes. As a result of this new strategy, potential cocaine production in Colombia has dropped significantly. The crops moved back to Peru and Bolivia, the processing facilities to Venezuela and Ecuador, and the activities of drug trafficking to Mexico and Central American countries. In other words, the situation in Colombia has improved significantly, but our neighbors have become the direct victims of our own success in Colombia. As long as there is demand for drugs, there will be someone willing to take the risk of satisfying it. And as long as there are large illegal revenues coming from illegal drug markets, the associated levels of violence will remain. Unfortunately, not everything is good news, and the challenges that lie ahead are enormous. Organized criminal groups and emerging gangs have adapted very quickly, as they have always done, to the changes implemented in security policies by the Colombian government. For instance, the recent involvement in other illegal activities, such as illegal gold mining, has generated again a pronounced cycle of violence in some parts of the country that the authorities must confront in order for the problem not to get out of control. Another policy challenge that has gone relatively unnoticed in the discussion about public policy in Colombia relates to drug consumption. This has most likely been a consequence of the excessive emphasis and attention that we have given in Colombia to supply reduction policies under Plan Colombia and to the fight against organized crime. Although consumption prevalence rates in Colombia are still low when we compare them to countries such as Chile, Argentina, Brazil, and Uruguay, their evolution over time is quite worrying. The government has the huge task of gathering the experience of other countries regarding treatment and prevention of drug consumption and, together with the Ministry of Education, outline a strategy for reducing drug consumption. It is very important that these programs and strategies implemented are systematically evaluated, again, with the purpose of knowing what works and what doesn't in terms of reducing drug consumption. I would like to finish by telling you about a new initiative at the Universidad de Los Andes. Given the enormous interest and great reception of the book in academic and political circles, Universidad de Los Andes, headed now by President Pablo Navas, promoted the idea of establishing a new center, the Center for the Study of Drugs and Security. The new center will have as its main objective to promote new research, analysis, and policy documents in order to foster a deeper debate based on the available evidence about the effectiveness, efficiency, and cost of security and drugs policy. The main objective of these studies and policy papers will be to inform public policy discussions and provide information, analysis, and evaluations that policymakers require in the process of designing and implementing public policies in these areas. Another important activity of the new center will be to promote policy debates, conferences, and discussions about drugs and security policies. For instance, in May of next year, the center will host the 7th annual meeting of the International Society for the Study of Drug Policy. This year's meeting starts tomorrow at the University of Kent. This academic society brings together more than 150 international scholars that have dedicated their lives to the study of drugs policy. It is also worth mentioning that this will be the first time that this international academic society holds its annual meeting outside of the US or Europe and at the same time in a drug reduction country. 40 years after the declaration of the war on drugs, the debate about effectiveness and the enormous cost of the current prohibitionist stance is quite heated. Several former Latin American presidents and leading intellectuals from around the world have drawn attention to the ineffectiveness and adverse consequences of the current prohibitionist stance. This book is a contribution from Universidad de Los Andes to an urgent debate that needs now more than ever informed analysis that transcend ideological positions and the inertia of political decisions. Thank you very much.